Okay, we'll call the meeting to order. We do have some minutes, which everyone got, I think.
We did.
At some point in time. Were there any questions? Minutes? If you can read them.
We can read them.
Okay.
I make a motion to accept the minutes as submitted.
Motion, is there a second?
Second.
Any questions? All those in favor of the minutes?
Aye.
Opposed? This is a vote. All right. Most of our meeting is town administrator's report tonight, and...
Well, I'll be brief then.
I know.
We'll get out of here.
I have written some things down for my meeting. One was, of course, the O'Malley situation, just as much as you can. I don't know if you're ready to do any budget projections.
I can give you, just up to date.
Yeah, okay, I'll let you go and do whatever you've got on your...
In terms of the O'Malley case, the Board of Selectmen has voted to move forward with an appeal. Beyond that, I think you've probably seen, hi Frank, you've probably seen the amounts reported in the paper. They are accurate as reported.
Pull up a chair.
So they will be, you know, they have filed the appropriate paperwork with the courts for it. I don't know how long it will take, or...
What was the settlement?
It wasn't a settlement, it was an award. It was a judgment, a little over $500,000.
And of that amount?
That included legal fees.
And that, one of the questions that came up is funding to pay for that comes out of our...
Reserves.
Reserves.
Or it can be raised directly on the recap sheet as well. It's a line for court judgments.
How, in your opinion, we will head of the game at the town meeting if it comes up? What about the subject matter and paying for it? And what accounts it may, what effect it may have on the taxes, etc.? What is your, how should we handle it?
You know, without getting into too much detail of what the expectations are, I think, I mean, on the good, we're in a good position to be able to pay it. We are adequately funding our reserves. I mean, I'm sure you've heard me talk ad nauseam about emergencies, extraordinary, unforeseen, those types of things. You know, we are poised to pay this judgment should, you know, we go through an appeal and be found that we would have to. That being said, that is not what, you know, you want to fund your reserves adequately for. We'd like to see it go a lot further. But we're in a position to pay it. Probably I would see it raised right on the recap.
What? With that kind of question, would that be something where we would weigh in even though this is under appeal?
I don't think so. No, I'd be reluctant to speak on anything until it's all.
What would be the time frame on the appeal?
The appeal, based on the best information that we have from our current attorneys, it could exceed a year.
Okay. And what are the possible outcomes as a result of an appeal?
Possible outcomes is we would pay the judgment as awarded.
Would it increase because of the time?
Oh, well, I should say that. We would be subject to interest.
Yeah.
Any judgment is subject to interest. So. Okay. But there could be a settlement, or it could be overturned on appeal, or the appeals court judges could.
What is the interest rate that they apply to?
I don't know.
The interest rate's not that high, but I get the sense that these are
higher. It's higher than what you're earning on your savings account.
Oh, yeah. No question, but I mean, yeah. the other aspect is the legal fees incurred by the town in supporting our is this exceeding our standard budget amount?
No, we have our attorneys on retainer, so it doesn't cost us any additional money. Other than if there were mailings that had to go out, things like that, there are incremental incidentals.
But they're not doing it per hour.
No.
No.
Nothing prohibited.
Now, is it, you know, given the sense you said that it was like this would go a year, that it probably won't come out of this year, that'd be...
Probably not. I don't expect that it would.
Is it your professional opinion that we should salt some money away and do some accounting? If we get the reserve accounts, or if we get free cash, or just wait it out?
I think we should wait until we have a determination of what's on our mind.
So it'd be twenty?
It could be.
You wanna say anything? You mentioned attorney.
But we also, we do have a new firm representing us, Lee Talum and Coster, the attorneys. We went out for an RFQ, and the board of selectmen did vote. There were three proposals. One was from Devon Page, one was from Ginny Creamer, and the other was from Lee Talum and Coster. And the board did decide to go with Lee's Meets firm. So they would be handling the appeal for us.
And this still, this is, this type of attorneys all retained for the town under the $75K budget, right?
Yes.
That we have put together.
Yes.
And they'll be also available for town meeting?
Yes.
As Ginny has been?
Yes. Yep, that's included in it. Budget proposals were due about a week ago. I'm still waiting for a couple of them. I sent them a nice note telling them that they were level funded. Since I didn't receive budget documents from them, I expect they'll all be on my desk first thing tomorrow morning.
You lose 5% a day.
Exactly.
5% a day, you lose.
Yeah, right. So I started conducting the hearings, going through the various departmental presentations. I wanted to find out from you guys how you wanted to handle it this year. In some years, you've requested certain departments come before the finance committee as well. Did you have certain ones you wanted to see? Do you want to base it on those departments that have the most significant changes? Do you have a feeling about that?
Where do we? We had the fire department last year, but the fire department's always going to be one of the larger
ones. Yeah, it's one of the things that can, you know, is I looking at it last year, they did a very comprehensive analysis of cost of which they proposed, and I got the impression that was phase one of a multiple phase type of dialogue with us, and I think it was wise. And the other thing was is this retainer. I know that we've historically paid retainers to the private companies, and we used to do Protection One, which is now part of the town. We don't do the retainer. And my
the lease. Well, lease. The lease.
I guess you would call it. And now the question, for example, in my mind, maybe if I were, is there any looking at the value of the lease at the same amount? Because we're covering their costs more than we ever did before, as I understand it. Maybe I'm wrong in that sense.
What we did a couple of years ago was, we didn't have any formal agreements, and I wasn't quite sure what those payments were for. So what we did was we put together lease agreements, and we agreed to lease the facilities and all the apparatus, so all the equipment, the breathing systems. Well, actually, I think that's ours. I take that back. Everything that we didn't own that we were using. So we put together comprehensive lease agreements, identifying all the equipment. When we purchased the Morgan Ave station, that lease payment went away. So now we just are making the one, I believe it's $80,000 a year. We pay them for the use of their facilities and all of their company-owned equipment. So that, I mean, I think we're in the second year of a three-year.
Yeah, historically that type of retainer was to offset some of their operating costs as well. I understand maybe changing the language of the lease agreement makes it different, but you know the view as to how accurate that amount is for that amount, for that, you know, updating it, you know, how much is it? $80,000 is the right amount. Should we pay less? Because now we're covering all the costs. When that lease agreement was signed, we weren't covering the hose testing, or you know, there were so many things in that $160,000. That I was struck by how detailed it was, and how we're paying for this and testing the ladders, and now for testing their fire equipment.
As those costs shift.
That's correct. We're testing. They're testing the pumpers and the ladders and the equipment and this and that. which they used to pay as part of the service to keep their equipment up to standard, and that, and which the $80,000 was in play for. Maybe we're not doing that, maybe it lowers the amount, and have some dialogue about, not, no surprises, but factually say, well, yeah, guys, we're paying the testing, we're paying the whole test, you used to do that under the initial lease agreement, we need, I understand lease agreements run for a period of time.
Yeah, and that makes perfect sense, and as we get into the negotiation of the next agreement, that certainly will be part of the conversation, as well as the fact that we're entering into purchasing the equipment now.
That's correct.
So we're looking at purchasing a ladder truck and a popper. As the town purchases those, and they're no longer the company's property, obviously that lease payment will be coming down.
When's the current lease, do you know, or sorry, you had one around?
I think we've got one more year, 2019 is the last year, but
Now that we started talking, I think this is our second year, so one more.
Well, Richard, it made sense, and I agree, and but, you know, I think that it's just a question of understanding that maybe the cost shifting is occurring, because again, that comprehensive operating budget cost structure that we were kind of equal, the 80-80 came to 160, I always, and the numbers always differ.
Right.
But it kind of covered everything more or less, and that still retains that type of.
Yeah, no, that's a very good point.
Well, I would think that any particular large-scale capital expense we want to have a look at, and or any significant increases in personnel, typically full-time personnel.
Yeah, the initial presentation does not call for any new.
Well, that's, you know, I understand they maintain last time here, no.
Fire.
But, you know, the concept of the ambulance coverage is wrapping up, I think, is staffing up. Fire protection and ambulance protection, you know, kind of considered under the fire department umbrella, one and the same, even though they do break it out. And it was some sensitivity as to what the future growth in that aspect of it. And to me, it's just a question of a slippery slope when you're paying people 20 hours a week to do the service, when do they gravitate over that they lobby for the benefits and say, well, we want the benefits that are associated with doing this job, which probably is rightfully theirs to discuss. We had a situation, I don't know much about it, but we entered town meeting last time, there was a petition of people outside the hall asking us to extend benefits of sick time and vacation time to our full-time employees. I don't know what it was all about, but it just put me off that there was some type of emotion to try, and I said, you're getting the sense that.
Did you say full-time or part-time?
There was people outside asking, so what?
Yeah, that's what I.
Passing the petition around about benefits.
To part-time?
Well, I don't know which one, but I didn't get into, I didn't listen to it, but I just was taken aback of a petition to.
I believe it was part-time.
Yeah.
It was 15-hour, was it, if I'm not mistaken, was it the $15 an hour minimum wage and part-time employee?
I don't know, but you're getting a sense of the tip of the iceberg, because we're reaching the critical mass.
Part-time employees in Massachusetts have to be given sick time up to 40 hours a year, but they earn it at a certain rate. But that was mass law that changed based on a voter referendum across the board.
Well, benefits are still.
But benefits are still, yeah.
From FinCom's perspective, you know, I think that the unknown future is what it relates to what their plans are and staffing. The other thing is that to revisit the separate enterprise fund for the ambulance service, I know that my research says that that's a three-year commitment that you have to, and the concept behind the enterprise fund is to allow the town to look at the operation and kind of get back to the town and say, here's what we're doing, here's what it's praying, here's what we're getting, and at some point in time, you know, it's not ad infinitum, there stays as an enterprise fund only for the payment of ambulance services.
Right.
You know, when you want to roll it over to general funds, or no, public safety funds, I mean, something like that.
General fund.
Well, public safety funds.
Well, it has to be.
No, general fund, or it stays an enterprise fund.
Yeah, well, general funds, okay. But the idea, but that's something that, so, I mean, and I got the sense from the last great presentation we got was, you know, some idea as to what their plans are fiscally, as to understand, you know, I understand, you know, what are we looking at 160, you know, for expenses, or we're looking for more expenses.
Okay, so what I'm hearing is you'd like to see fire.
I'd like to see fire. Is there anything that you would recommend, is there anything in DPW or in any other areas that you would say is, would, when we look at it, we're gonna be, wow, they're asking for a big increase.
I haven't gone through all of them. Certainly police are one of the other larger budgets. I don't know when the last time I saw that.
We can't distinguish one over the other. It's public safety is an expense, and we're going through a transition period, moving from the old to the new.
I think it would be good to have both police and fire.
Yeah, as a public safety.
And I like to gravitate to some commitment for the town that this is what they're into. Because we're making this major fiscal commitment to these operations. And yet, I don't know whether it has been properly presented to the town that this is what we're going to be looking at, guys. Because we're now buying equipment we never did before. We bought one truck, we're buying two. Where we have two separate ambulance, private ambulance companies, now we have one, and it's consolidated. We have one fire department, and we're looking at what they're going to be looking, and comparing to other towns. I mean, I had a conversation with the folks in Raleigh at some meeting I attended, and they don't have an ambulance service. They go with a different service. And they don't have a full fire department, you know, they have one shift from the day, they don't have second and third shift. You know, so it isn't that what they're doing is inappropriately, it may be better than not, but the idea is, this is what, and some justification, people are very strong in opinion, this is what the town wants and should have, which is a full-time, 365, 24/7 staff fire department. And I would like to see that presented and understood, especially the aspect of retirement benefits.
Are you saying Raleigh doesn't have 24/7?
No. Well, see, that's the thing.
You did a good job, Larry, of opening that box at the last, honestly, you did.
Well, I just
made people aware.
I just think that they should say, yes, we want, this is, we're back, it's, we know. You know, because right now, we're looking at a gradual consumption of our public service funds significantly into these enterprises, and they're fine. And yet, you look at what is going on in the surrounding towns.
Five-year look ahead for both of those folks in terms of what do they see happening?
You know, and you,
that, make
the
that makes sense. And also, I'm thinking that to Larry's point about having it be in front of the town was that one of the things we talked about, I'm looking back at the notes from the minutes from last meeting, was that having a formal, the presentation is supposed to come from more than just the finance committee.
Yeah.
So that if we are looking at it, then this year there is a significant increase in services and financial outlay, maybe that's a part where we get a presentation from public safety explaining that as we head into annual town meeting.
Okay.
As part of the, because I think then that brings the discussion by making it part of the presentation, because there was no discussion over the bylaw, the change to the strong chiefs rule.
Right.
There was absolutely no discussion, so there was no opportunity. No one asked a question at town meeting, so we didn't have the opportunity to explain it. People just voted, and we lost that opportunity. That's the type of thing where if we foresee that it's going to be, I missed last year's town meeting because I was on vacation, but if we foresee that the amount requested, we need to call upon the experts there to say this is why we're changing it and explain the whys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think
rationale
and
from a public safety perspective, and we weigh in on whether the costs seem reasonable for that.
Well,
it gives the town the opportunity, the voters, an opportunity to really understand what's there. Because if they see a line item that went up from $300,000 to $400,000, just to use round numbers, but just say, we've lost that opportunity for the education.
This is the plan.
We need a plan.
I'd like to add the personnel department into that dialogue, because I believe the staffing levels or the payment scale, which is going to be applied to those employees, are significantly different than what it will be. You look at our chief's role and what he's going to get compensated. What's the standard compensation? I know personnel will look at surrounding towns and say, well, you look at the Raleigh chief, he's getting, say, for the sake, 130, and we're paying our guy 60-something. You know, that's going to change.
Right, and that's part of that projection.
And then you get it exactly. And then I would like to add, whatever does this is that we get into the retirement commitment. If we're putting the staff on, what's the impact on Essex County retirement, so that we're now adding people to our longevity retirement roles. We've always been a town, very conservative, very few people get on that. We do pay a premium, and we should, but the idea is that we've never had a significant amount of people
involved in that conversation, and I think that.
Eligible to move into that, and they will. And they will move into those, you know, I think the fire department one is like, you're after 50 years of life, and so many years involved, you can go for retirement. It isn't 65, you know, with the, it's 50 years. And that has a, and no one's really outlined what that could look like.
They do that, well, not what it could look like. They do for.
Actuarial.
Actuarial protection, that's what we pay that, 25, that 5,000. So what about a date or time? What's best, would be best in their timeframe too, and how you are? February meeting?
You tell me.
Is that soon enough?
It is soon enough, because we're crunched because of the April town meeting now. And we have to get everything done by the end of March, and our March meetings were primarily, as you know last time, pushing forward votes on recommendations.
Or maybe not. That would be.
So our February meeting is the 6th of February.
Would be the 6th. I mean, they've probably given you their budget or not.
They've presented their budgets to me, so I can get them scheduled for 6th. Do you want them right at the beginning of the meeting?
I think that's gives them, yeah, that's respectful of their time.
Half an hour each, or?
Do you want them both, same night, fire and police? Yes.
Yes, because I think we just don't have enough time to stretch it out. I'd rather not have to have another meeting, I'd rather.
Okay, half an hour is enough time.
I'm just wondering about half an hour.
If we get the budgets in advance.
Yeah, yeah, if it gives the budgets in advance, then we can.
Do questions. If we have to go through the whole presentation, no, it would not be enough.
Yeah. Okay, you got that, Jen?
Yeah, I think that's.
Of course you do.
Definitely.
Magic pen.
Is there anything else out of public safety that you think is?
Nope, they're putting the final details on their specifications for the proposals, and they'll be presenting them to CPC.
Who is?
For fire.
Oh, fire.
Fire. And the, in terms of the public safety building, the architect has been chosen, but we've yet to negotiate the contract yet, so that's in the works.
In regards to the equipment assessment study that you had done, there was an extensive amount of commentary or suggestions, you know, replace this, replace that, which was much greater than what we're looking at that acoustics equipment. They had a kind of a schedule for everything else. Is that still in vogue? Is that still in play?
I mean, it's a resource. They're using it as they evaluate their equipment needs. But
there's no questioning to whether or not it's valid or not. For example, there was some stated they're replacing a couple of pieces of equipment this year, and I, whatever the case may be, but you know, now we're looking at what else is that do they have in the queue? Because the study says you should replace this unit, you should replace that unit, you should replace this unit. How many more units are there that have been identified by the study?
Yeah.
And do they have a projection, like you said, you're 5 years? Because like one of the things that you know was intriguing.
That should be included.
Yeah.
They were talking about the Byfield Fire Department has a forest unit, which they put together themselves, very traditional Newbury, and the recommendation was you'd have to get rid of it because we have no way of assessing it as a valid piece of equipment. And
well, that's their comment.
Then,
well, that's the comment of the study. The
right.
Question, what took place in my mind is the study was given to not to us, but it was given to the selectmen. And there was tacit agreement that, okay, whatever they said goes. And I don't know if that's the case.
I'm not sure that that's the right assumption there.
Well.
Yeah.
I don't see anybody push back.
Let's see what it looks like when they come in, we'll know.
Right.
Well, the report's out. The report's here.
No, that's all I'm saying.
But it's whether or not they acted on the report.
That's the report. What's their recommendation with respect to that?
That's correct. That's
I write a lot of reports. I make a lot of recommendations. Not everybody does what I recommend.
I can't imagine.
Now, on the not to leave the fire department, the two pieces of equipment, in terms of the lease purchase, when do we town has voted that, but we.
Town meeting has voted the capital outlay in the line item, but it hasn't gone before CPC yet. The expectation was that they would have had the specifications done by now, but there was a little bit of a lag. I think they started them this time last year, if I'm not mistaken. And things got a little complicated with changing and the personnel and all the adjustments we've made within the department.
So when do we expect to see figures?
Well, I can tell you what, it's about 1.5 million.
When are we expected to make some, take some action, I guess, as a finance committee?
Well, once you go through CPC is.
We haven't even seen it, CPC.
So we haven't seen it.
I mean, as far as taking action.
Well, knowing where that money's coming from, whether or not we should.
It's coming from the capital.
Whether or not we should, whether or not we should think about what's the impact on our operating budget? And is it such an impact that we ought to look at funding that through an override or through a debt exclusion? I mean, looking at the big picture.
Yep.
That's gonna take a chunk of money out.
Oh, yeah, for sure. The reason it was funded in the operating budget, the line item operating budget, goes back to Larry's point. We looked at the plan that the consultant had provided and became very much aware to, you know, became very much aware of the fact that we were gonna have a lot of replacements. And although these were, can expect to be paying for 10 years, as these are gonna be coming off, more are gonna be going on. So that was why it was put in the line item. That doesn't prohibit you from saying, okay, we're not gonna do that, we just wanna do a capital exclusion.
We're still operating on some, in my opinion, some money that normally would not be there because of the situation with the schools.
But no, that money went into the stabilization fund intentionally.
If I did my, if I do the numbers, you know, our operating budget is still significantly better.
Without a doubt.
With the school, because of the schools, you know.
Right.
But that may not last.
It may not last, and that's.
It should, in my opinion.
That's why I tried to be extremely disciplined in what we did with that money.
And not allocate it into operating budgets,
but put it into stabilization, so when the date came that it turned, it would be easier than, you know, trying to lay people off and cut budgets and the whole thing, so.
Okay. All right. Anything else on that? Anything else? Let me look at my notes.
Are you back from New Zealand now?
Yeah.
When is the next CPC meeting?
I have to talk to Tracy and see when we're gonna have some, so. I think we have one scheduled.
The Williamson property. Oops.
I can't remember. Williamson property that.
That was sort of narrowly defeated.
That was very narrowly defeated. It's my understanding, although it hasn't been formally voted, but the intention was to bring it forward. Again, the one caveat that they wanted adjusted in the purchase and sale agreement was it was going to be subject to successful permitting. Because that was obviously, that's always a question mark until you get there, so that the transfer wouldn't occur until when you get the permit.
So selectmen hadn't really acted on it.
The selectmen put that caveat.
What property is that? Is that the corner of Route 1?
31 Plum Island Boulevard.
That's the Plum Island property that was narrowly defeated, purchase was narrowly defeated at special town meeting.
And was that accepted?
No.
Would that be?
As far, do we have an executed agreement?
Yeah, on that.
It is, as far as I know, his attorneys have it. I don't know if it's been executed yet. That kind of transferred with the attorneys, so.
Seems that might have been.
But the selectmen haven't taken any action with respect to bringing it back to town meeting.
No, they won't do that until we get to the warrant.
Okay. Frank, you had a question you can tell.
Well, my question was whether that was the former doctor's office.
Oh, it's not.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
But I would suggest that whatever the selectmen propose, that it be fully costed, not just for the building, but fully costed for what it's gonna take to develop that operational.
Develop it.
The acquisition of parking spaces, the safety issues, the police issues.
Those are all questions that were brought up, weren't they?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Again, going back to the idea that if we're doing this, there'll be a presentation made by a group larger than this behind it to say, this is the first step, we expect that the other steps will be blah, 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 and that gets discussed and introduced before being behind the eight ball, whatever first question comes at us about it.
Yeah, Ron Barrett's gonna ask, answer the question about whether or not Bruce Tor is actually gonna come up with money.
The selectmen have had a num, I can't speak to Senator Shire's conversations with Ron Barrett, but the selectmen have had conversations with Senator Tarrant in which he has renewed his commitment to work with us to seek funds for the renovation, quote unquote.
I understand, and that's gobbledy, well.
We understand what
you
mean by
that. Several layers to unpack there.
Yes.
That's
been working with us to try to fund the schools appropriately for 40 years.
Correct. Yeah. Understood.
Lip service.
He'll be here.
I'm sorry.
That's what we have.
Senator, excuse me.
A commitment to work with us to get
money. But they all do that, you know.
Of course. No, it's not smart enough to realize what it is.
I want to see the check. Show me the money.
Right.
Okay.
Thanks.
And you're in the process with the police contract, right?
Yes, we had our first negotiation session in which it became apparent, and it was actually some of the numbers that I had received from the Massachusetts Municipal Personnel Association. They've made claims over the years about being significantly underpaid relative to those communities in Essex County who are closest to us. And have been able to demonstrate through the data analysis that we actually have quite a significant number of additional costs as well. So this may be a year of reckoning for us.
Does personnel board involved in that? Personnel board?
Yes.
Yeah.
They don't sit at the table in the negotiations,
it's just you and their attorney or
their representative. I'm not sure if she's an attorney.
Okay. I had an off-point question, but I'm sorry I was late getting here. I apologize, but you guys started a little bit early, I thought.
Right at 7.
Okay. Well, was that first issue a lawsuit from, was that have to do with the Harbor Master? Or what,
yes.
What,
yes.
Yeah, that was, right. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, it's, they're appealing it. Yeah.
And my second question is, has our former legal counsel, the firm, been replaced?
Yes.
Who was the firm? Was it Bowman?
No, Bowman and Penske was our previous attorney. They dissolved, and this we were working with Kramer Law, who was a principal in the Bowman Penske firm. But now we're with Mead, Talaman, and Costa.
Okay. Well, I'm just curious because John Bowman actually used to date my wife.
Okay, we're moving right along.
When we were in college,
we don't want to get you in trouble, Frank. She may watch the movie here.
It was a long time ago.
Okay, let's see. Anything else from the town administrator that I have in my notes?
Just an observation that growth taxes, I mean, the town was like, is it fiscally moving in the right direction?
We are. I did some. I plan to include in the budget document this year a 5-year financial forecast, and you know, putting some of the numbers together, the forecast looks pretty good.
You see a lot of construction. I mean,
yep.
As a layman, I don't know that, but there's
not a lot of subdivision growth. But
is there a lot of plans for those big subdivisions?
No.
Okay.
No, we might have one on the horizon. It won't impact us in 2019, but the following year. 5 or 6 homes, but that's, you know.
We could tax those storage units as homes. Building more, too, I think, back there.
Yep.
So
maybe at some point we should have a little discussion or presentation by this community planning committee to see if they have any plans for growth.
You mean master plan?
The master plan.
Okay.
That's
we'll get to right into that next, as a matter of fact.
That's a good segue.
What a
good segue, Frank.
Good Frank.
We got CPC, MPC.
Okay, CPC, I don't have anything.
Right, okay.
From.
Nothing yet.
To do. And for the municipal planning committee, or master plan committee.
Yeah.
We met actually the day after our last meeting, and I had presented some information about municipal septic systems. And they have asked me to go out and get some more information and maybe look at what it would take to do a study in the town of Newbury for that. And so I'm preparing that for our next meeting. There's been some, we have time for it. There's some really interesting stuff that came out of the Merrimack Valley Planning Commission. And presentations with respect to the fact that lack of infrastructure is one of the things that actually keeps us from being as diversified as we could be. And we are not a very diverse population. Certainly not as much as we were due to the cost of housing. Yeah. And so they're looking at that. I see the same thing in Massachusetts with the governor. Looking for more housing units, but we couldn't do that unless we changed infrastructure.
You're referring to economic diversity.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's what I have.
DCC, I didn't make the meeting, but I, did anyone make that last meeting? I do know, and everybody's probably gotten the email, that on the 27th of January, they're going to have a Suzanne Bumpus, I think is she, or?
Suzanne Bump, yeah.
Bump?
Yeah.
She's the auditor, probably is be, going to be, is it, I'm sorry, it is the 25th.
It's Thursday, the 25th, right?
Thursday, the 25th. I am not here. Frank, you were the other person that
I thought it was, this is a meeting at Triton?
Yes.
That, it's the 25th, I thought.
Yes, it is.
Well, I can be there, but.
Yeah, and it would be good for as many as possible to be there.
It's
two meetings, three.
Is there a DCC specific meeting, or there's, I know there's one that Brian's pushed out to the all parents.
I thought that that was pushed out to that, but.
Yeah, I think it is, I think it's a, it's.
Scheduled for that meeting, or you want to just?
I'm trying to find my.
25th.
Yeah.
It is Thursday, the 25th.
Right, it's two meetings, one at 6:30, one at 7, or 6 and 7, or 6, 6, 6:30.
I don't have that detail in my head.
I can send it out.
I've got a 6:30, I've got Thursday, this going out to the whole.
Everybody.
The whole Duke Regional School District.
And he's looking for responses, I think, right?
What time is it, 6:30, you said? Out of that meeting?
6:30 on the.
25th.
On the 25th.
Okay.
Yeah, you have a long email about it, I've forgotten the details, but.
The document, you've read some of it, or.
I read it.
It's lengthy.
Oh, it really deals with the inadequate funding of regional school systems. And I think, you know, the concept of trying to change the formula, and the only caveat of value is that state's commitment to increase transportation reimbursement is probably the only thing that we could hope for as a positive out of it. But, you know, it's, you know, I think the thing is, it was highlighted by the folks at Raleigh, they're saying, you know, we have declining enrollments. And, you know, but the cost structure doesn't really reflect those things, and it's hard to maintain, you know, a school when you have to, because our enrollment has gone down substantially. I think that on the positive side, I think Triton's dealing with school choice has been significant. We don't see that major negativity on their books they used to have. It was over in excess of $1 million per year, and school choice funds out. But how long that lasts, who knows? You know, it's kind of trendy.
So anyway, anybody and everybody that can go, except me, would be good. Item 5, we've actually already talked about, so we'll be having. The timeline, have you made any changes to that budget timeline?
The only change is I added the deadline for special articles, which doesn't impact you guys.
Okay.
January 15th, and that's all the department managers to have notified.
Everybody have a copy of the, you sent it out by email, I believe. Calendar?
Yep. You sent it, I gave it to you, and you sent it up to me.
Okay.
Resend it?
I can resend that.
Resend.
Resend, please. Resend, because it's coming quickly.
Always does.
Okay. Any other business? Anything anyone's mind?
And the next meeting, are we going to get, when's our next quality review of the performance numbers, do you think? At March?
The
Fed.
Frank's reports.
Next meeting. Next meeting. Next meeting we'll get, end of, we'll get December, we'll get the second one. Yes. Frank's reports.
Plan on a long meeting next time.
So.
Police firing for you.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. No transfers anticipated.
No rule of budget, you don't want?
Talk to me next week.
Larry would like to hire the town to plow a pathway tomorrow from his house.
Not tomorrow.
No, Thursday, to Logan Airport. What time do you have to be there?
We have to be there sometime.
You and I both.
Oh, you're going Thursday. Oh, yes, it is. From 8 to 12.
Well, yeah, living in, funny, living in the wind, it's better than hurricanes in 20.
Next meeting is February. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Well, the next meeting was February 6th?
February 6th.
All right, okay, that's good.
February 6th.
So moved?
Second? Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.